automating a text analysis problem as otherwise done using time-intensive manual methods. The Bechdel test was first introduced by Alison Bechdel in a comic strip she wrote in 1985. In the comic strip, a character proclaims she only goes to a movie if it contains two female characters who at some point talk to each other about something other than a man. So these are the three criteria that make up the Bechdel test. T1, are there at least two mean female characters? T2, do these female characters have a conversation with one another at some point? And T3, is there at least one conversation with female characters about something other than a man? And they can also be expressed as a score. So if a film doesn't fulfill any of the criteria, it's of course 0, it was all 3, and it has a score of 3. My thesis wasn't about judging Hollywood, so it's about the text analysis, the interesting text analysis problems that these three questions provide us.
The females in the T3 have to be the same ones as in T1?
The criteria build up on each other. So
it has to be two.
It has to happen once in the film. At some point, there has to be two female characters who have a conversation with each other about something other than a man. Yeah. Sorry. So you can't test T3 and not pass T1. This is I analyzed two different types of text. So screenplays, which are a proxy for movies, and then novels.
So 3 is good. 3 is the highest score?
Exactly. So you want to get 3. And in 2016, approximately 40% of films did not pass the Bechdel test. So it seems fairly easy and trivial. But like, for example, the original Star Wars movies don't pass. There's Princess Leia, but she never talks to another female character So the first text of the word screenplays. Before we can get started analyzing T1 and T2, we have to pre-process the screenplay. So if you can kind of see, this is what a screenplay looks like. It's a very well-formatted document with 5 types of lines. And these are the lines that the parsing step wants to assign each of the lines one of these labels. So there's a scene boundary line, which marks the beginning of the scene. Scene description, which provides more description about the scene. C are character lines, that's the name of the character who says the following dialogue, the T lines. And there are 2 types of metadata lines, so others, those aren't really relevant for the Bechdel test. As you can see in the example, there are a few defining characteristics. So capitalization plays an important role. There are certain lines that are in all caps, and there are certain ones that aren't. Keywords are important, so for scene boundaries, there are certain keywords that appear. Indentation is important, so when does the text start? You can see there's 5 different indentation levels in this program. And we use these characteristics to develop a rule-based parsing approach to parse the screenplay. So indentation levels play an important role in that. Indentation levels vary widely from screenplay to screenplay, so when you look online, you can find tons of screenplays, and they're not uniformly formatted at all. But within a screenplay, the indentation levels are usually consistent. So this is a graph of the indentation levels within a certain screenplay. You can see there are peaks, and that's where those certain lines are.
What's the y-axis? I'm sorry, I can't read it.
Number of occurrences. So how often certain indentation levels appear, the number of spaces. And this is the decision tree that we came up with first. And it uses those 3 characteristics like mentioned. So keyword, yes, no, and then the indentation levels, and it goes down, and in the end, you can parse the script in that way fairly well. So now that we can parse the screenplay, we know which lines belong to the character names. And for T1, we want to assign each of these character names a gender. So initially, I thought I could do the dictionary approach. There are so many online databases full of names and genders. I could just take that. That proves to be wildly insufficient. First, because of unisex names. So that you just can't tell with lots of English names if it's a female or a male. And then in the screenplay, often a character is referred to by their first name. So General Patton or Professor Brown. And so you can't tell gender based solely on what the C line is. So therefore, we connected the data film to the IMDb database. And there we only have to connect the name in the screenplay to the name in the IMDb graph. whatever the first attempt to say it, we're using a dictionary approach. If it's too uncertain, then we use an activity approach. And if the IMDb process is certain, then we can't use that character to pass one. So then we have to define which characters converse with each other. So in when you're watching a movie, it's you know who is conversing with each other based on the camera angles and dialogue and stuff. In the screenplay, it's more difficult. So we took the parsing labels that we obtained in the parsing step and tried two different approaches. So we can break down the scene, break down the movie into scenes. So a conversation can't take place over the scene boundaries. We used to try a liberal approach. So in the example scene above, we would say that character one converses with character two and character four because they're all together in the scene. This proved to be too generous. So we allowed a lot of films to pass T2 that don't actually pass T2. So then we used a conservative approach where we define characters conversing with another character only if they appear consecutively within that parsing array. And then the result of this is a social network analysis. So we have the characters, those are the nodes, and the edges between the characters represent the characters who at some point in the film converse with each other. And for T3, so two of these female characters converse with each other, talk about something other than the M. We use a machine learning approach. So first we have to find features. There are four main categories of features that we use, bag of word features. So we're not treating the line, what is actually said in the dialogue. And that normalizes the binary, so certain words value. And then we use linguistic features. So we took a number of conversations between the pairs of female characters, a number of words exchanged during their conversation. Is there a mention of a male pronoun or a male character in their conversation? A mention does not necessarily lead to that being about the man, the conversation is about the man. But a male character can be mentioned and it's about something completely different. Is there a mention of a male pronoun or a male character in all the features? Because the number of female characters varies from film to film, we have to normalize these. So we calculated the maximum, minimum, mean, and the standard deviation. So in total, we have 16 features.
Question. I see that this link approach is basically to define if they are conversing about a man or not. What's the purpose of this bag of words approach? What's the purpose of those features?
There could be certain words that would lead the machine learning algorithms to determine that if this word appears, then it's definitely about a man.
Okay, I see. So basically there were some keywords which were looked for, and then even if there's no explicit mention about a man, it's probably about a man.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Sure. So it's kind of a throw everything in.
Yep, I see. Mm-hmm.
And the third category were film features. So the rating, the length of the film, and the genre. The idea being an action film might be more or less likely to pass the
hypothesis. Yeah. Is conversation purely defined by two dialogue elements next to each other?
Next to each other.
Meaning one following the other?
Characters converse. Yeah, exactly.
And if there's three or four characters in the scene, it's still defined by two dialogue lines adjacent to each other.
So if like if character one talks to character two, talks to character three, and then talks to character one again?
But how do you know character one is talking to two and not three? If
that's how we define it in the conservative approach. So that's this last one. So we can take both of the parsing labels in the example.
Yeah.
So we have a scene, and we know that's when the scene starts. And we have a scene description. Character one says something, character two says something, and character four says something. And we found the approach that worked best was saying that character one, in this case, only converses with character two. And character two converses with character one and character four.
Although you can imagine both character one and character two are actually talking to character four.
It's not a perfect strategy.
No, I actually would like to follow on that question. That was a good one, I think. That what was the way of evaluation that liberal approach was actually too liberal? How did you prove it?
I have a training, so like a training system.
So
show.
Yeah, but basically you manually check that this character one, two, and four were in the same scene, and you check okay they were not supposed to be, or do you get it from somewhere?
There's a ground. There's a website called medicaltest.com or .org.
I see.
And that has the ground truth. Yeah, that's important.
Okay, so you already had the data.
So I already
I see.
This film passes T2, but doesn't pass T3.
I see.
And that's the basis then for the evaluation.
Sure. Thank you.
So sorry, I should have mentioned that. Yeah. And so this website is it's very comprehensive. So all of the films in our data set also appear on this website, and you have information about what the score is, so how many tests it passed, and then also there's an uncertainty feature. So it's a crowdsourced website. So when the new movie comes out, then like on the next day there's an entry in this website, and people can discuss. I don't think that's a real conversation. Like it's some of the criteria.
Yeah.
So. And the fourth type of features were So those use the graph that we created for T2 to calculate pre-centrality, post-centrality, between-centrality, the number of men and female characters connected to, and how many female characters connected to this female character. And those also need to be normalized, like for the alien features. And the normalization we used for the film features was one hot encoding.
Sorry, which one hot encoding?
One hot encoding is like where you have one, so like, for example, the rating. There's a G rating, a PG rating, and you have, so yes, no G rating, yes, no PG rating.
Okay.
So that way, otherwise you get a kind of a scaling in the variable. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you can have them select. So then I used support vector machine, regional-based kernel, the average five-fold cross-validation to determine. For this, I needed to penalize mistakes in the minority class. So I had more films that passed than failed. Or more films that failed than passed, sorry, of course. And so I needed to penalize the minority. So I don't optimize for accuracy. And this is the part of where my ground truth came from. The second type of text I looked at were novels. As you all know, novels lack the defined structure of screenplays. So the structure that we have in the screenplay does not exist in novels. And there's also no previous direct research about the audience that exists in novels. For this reason, our sample size was fairly small. So we analyzed 5 texts, 2 Jane Austen novels, Dickens novel, and 2 Sherlock short stories. The Jane Austen novels and the Dickens novel passed the Dickens test, and the Sherlock Holmes stories. Here we also need to do a pre-processing. So we ran 3 parsing steps over all of the text. We ran a named entity recognizer. So in the example here, the Christian went to the Eiffel Tower for the first time in 1990. We're only interested in the people, because for screenplays we knew who the characters were based on the sea lines. For novels we don't know. So we have to first determine who are the characters. But it's not as easy as just running an entity. And then ran a part of speech dagger, and then a co-reference resolution. So co-reference is when 2 or more expressions refer to the same character. So an example, Holmes chuckled and wriggled in his chair. His refers to Holmes as was his habit, Holmes's habit, when in high spirits, and then more important for determining that he speaks when it's said he. I mean, also for that. For T1, we leaned heavily on previous research for character detection in novels. Here, character names are represented as nodes, and the edges between the nodes are the character names that belong to the same character. So there's Sherlock Holmes, there's Mr. Holmes, there's Sherlock, and we'll need to all connect them to the same character, otherwise we might count a character more than once is actually the same. The algorithm contains 7 steps. But first, add edges between names that could possibly belong to the same character, and then erasing to make the edges that are illogical. So for example, we have, we connect characters with the same last name. We would connect Mr. Bennett, Elizabeth Bennett, Mrs. Bennett, we used a nickname database, so we could connect Elizabeth Bennett to Lizzie. Obviously, our connections here are not correct. So, and then we erased the edges that are illogical. So Mr. Bennett and Mrs. Bennett cannot possibly be the same character because Mr. and Mrs. are different genders. Mr. Bennett and Elizabeth Bennett for the same reason cannot possibly be the same character. Elizabeth Bennett and Mrs. Bennett appear in a sentence together, in part of a dialogue, so they cannot be the same character. And we'll have the true connection between Elizabeth Bennett and Elizabeth. So after we've determined who are the characters and which ones belong to the same, we need to determine for each piece of dialogue who said that piece of dialogue. So we have to attribute each quote to a character. And this is a rule-based approach. That was what we used in previous research, and there wasn't a lot of annotated data to use a machine learning approach. Initially, I wanted to use a machine learning approach, but the data just wasn't there. So there are five or six patterns that we used. So there's the target quote, the quote we can identify who's the speaker of, and we have a verb, and we have a character name that we know from T1. And when this pattern appears, then we say this quote is said by character. Then we have anaphora tigraph, which is similar, but instead of a character name, we have a verb. So she said this. It's the same thing. There's a target quote, there's a verb, and then there's a character, a reference that we can then link to a character. Dialogue chain is the third pattern. So there's a quote you already identified. No more have I, said Mr. Bennett. And then there's a target quote you want to identify. And because the target quote appears directly after the quote you identified, say that is also said by Mr. Bennett in this case. Then we have single mention, so within a paragraph, a target quote, there's only one character mentioned, and so this is the character that said that quote. Paragraph final is when the quote appears at the end of a paragraph, and we take the character who's been last mentioned before the quote. And then the last pattern is conversation. So we have quotes we've already identified, and then, like in the example, what's his name, asks Mrs. Bennett, Bingley. Is he married or single? Then we know from the pattern that is he married or single is said by the same character as the first one. So these are things that are very intuitive for us. When we read a novel, we know exactly who says which line, but programming a rule-based approach is difficult. And then for this we also use, so after we've identified who said each quote, we line them all up in an array and say this character versus this one. Due to the small sample size, there weren't any real iffy cases. So the algorithm was able to identify in all five, well actually in four because one novel doesn't pass T1, that which characters they correct the characters. So then we have T3. We want to determine is the conversation with something other than male. For this we use a simplified version. The annotated data wasn't there, so what is the conversation about? There just isn't the data really to be able to train a model using this. So we use, if there's a male character, a reference to a male character mentioned in the text, then it's about a male character. And for our small sample size, this worked perfectly. So in the Jane Austen novels, the text passed within the first chapter. There are so many female characters, which I mean, they talk about a lot of men, but they also talk about other stuff. And the only tricky case was the Dickens novel, A Christmas Carol. There's just one exchange between the mother and the daughter, and this is the exchange. Why was how late you are? You have a great deal of work, replied Martha. Yeah.
Question.
Yeah.
So basically, let's assume that this conversation goes on between those two characters, and in this moment there's no mention of a man, but mm-hmm. later on, let's say, a few sentences further, there is.
You just need one. Just need one.
That's considered still the same conversation.
Yeah, I don't consider it the same.
So basically, if there are like six sentences mm-hmm. and first two don't mention men, yeah. that's already passed this test.
It's a question of how you define a conversation.
Yeah, exactly. I'm just curious.
I defined it mm-hmm. so simpler.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
An exchange. But, yeah.
So basically, you have to have a conversation that's not exclusively about men.
Yeah.
The Did the Sherlock Holmes novels fail because there were conversations between women that always concerned men, or there just were no conversations between women?
Women conversations. But he wrote tons of novels, and I just looked at two. It would be interesting for future research to look at all of them. Maybe there's a development there. So for novels, I manually determined the grant ground truth, and I was able to correctly predict the battle score for all five novels. But of course, that's not the whole story. So interesting would be a large scale analysis with lots of text for maybe certain time periods.
How quickly could you just take everything you've done and apply it to, I don't know, Agatha Christie novels, which would be sort of an interesting, you've got a protagonist with those women.
Yeah, maybe if they're special, I would have to look at the text to see if I need to improve my character detection algorithms.
It would be interesting to see if that sort of failed the same Princess Leia test that
Right, the one female character can be as strong as, and that's the weakness of the big one, is there can be a strong female character and still not pass it. So in conclusion, the amount of available text is increasing. Having ways to automatically process this test, this data is vital to be able to gain the most information out of it and make large scale analysis as possible. For future research, I think using the actual video and audio from a movie would be interesting. Because a screenplay is only a proxy for a movie, so the screenplay could change. It could be a scene that just takes one scene, could be added. And what's currently being done, what I read about, is the amount of screen time male and female characters. That's also interesting. Any questions? Yeah?
Because in the movie, for example, Alien, come up with Tesla, does possibly.
I don't know about looking it up.
No.
Does anyone know? Does Alien pass? I can imagine it. I don't know. Well, she wasn't alone on the.
In the beginning.
I don't know. Yeah?
What happens, I'm just curious, when you have two conversations and, for example, both of the sides of the conversations are called she. She said, she replied, the other person replied, I don't know, something like that, like without specifically mentioning the name. I'm curious how your algorithm works in that case.
For novels or
For novels,
novels,
yeah.
Yeah. So for novels, it would say that these female characters converse with each other.
So those would that be recognized as two different characters?
That's why we need the co-reference resolution. So the co-reference resolution. So from the she, because when you read a novel, you don't read just she. It's
yes.
Elizabeth said this. She meant. So that's why. And
okay.
So the co-reference resolution attempts to to link the name mentioned previously to the reference of the she or the he, so that you can then later determine. It's from this character, and that's another character, or it's the same character.
And that's some predefined ready algorithm for that, which basically
uses
some advanced stuff
to
convert to Meredith's graph.
Yeah.
Okay, I see.
Thank you.
Alien passed 3 years speed test. The original one. So I don't have that much experience in NLP, so I'm kind of curious about how much of your time from the practical part was spent on data cleansing, the parsing part, the machine learning part. Can you
I should have taken notes on how much time, but that's the main work, so this parsing stuff.
Yeah.
If you have a good foundation to be able to build, and I know which are the character lines and which, then it makes it all so much easier. So that's why the parsing stuff is very important, and the pre-processing for the novel text also is the most important. And for the novels, I selected the text I used. Because there's a lot of previous research, so if you look at papers about novels, then those are the texts that often appear. The Pride and Prejudice, Dickens, the Chihuahua. So it's most of the time. And for the screenplays, I had a data set that I received from another researcher. So they could figure it out and figure out what it is.
I don't know if you mentioned that right now, but on what basis did you select these works? Because I think Sherlock Holmes is like a really bad example because it's from a first person perspective, and so all the conversations have a man in it.
Yeah.
So it's the chance that there are two women talking about something else is quite slim.
Yeah.
So I selected
the text based on previous research about the specific tasks. So the character detection. There's already annotated data, and I think they knew the ones who used the Sherlock.
Okay. So then
in order to test my algorithms, I looked at what they did.
Okay.
And that's why I selected those two.
Okay.
So, but it would be an interesting thing for me to become
totally new. Another thing I want to ask, did you look at the social network graphs? Because we also think it would be much smaller for the sort of Holmes ones. You took the features. I think they are really, really small.
Yeah.
Because there's Sherlock and Watson and one suspect or and one client maybe.
Yeah, definitely.
So,
they are much smaller. But then even the Pride and Prejudice and the whole is smaller. Just aren't, they talk a lot, but it's
I was just gonna say really cool work first. If in your free time, or somebody else was going to follow up with current films or television shows, they could actually use the subtitles, which are currently annotated in the English-speaking world.
Okay.
They're fairly complete. In the German-speaking world, some broadcasters like NDR actually highlight who's speaking by color.
Okay.
So you could actually short circuit using the video and audio and just go straight to the subtitles.
Yeah.
And I would imagine a broadcaster would be really interested to find out that all of their crime shows are actually failing the actual test. That would be really interesting.
You write an article about that, but it's interesting. Thanks.
How accurate was your algorithm for entity extraction? That worked well for you?
I don't know how accurate it was. It was 60%. There's room.